Well, thanks for coming this evening. I'm Katrina McKenzie. I'm the director of the Centre for Agency Values and Ethics at Macquarie University. It's a new university research centre with a focus on ethics. And one of our aims, one of the aims of our new centre, is to host two public lectures a year on ethical issues of national and global significance. So we're very delighted that Professor Thomas Pogge is going to give our inaugural public lecture for the centre for this year. Professor Pogge is Leitner Professor of Philosophy and International Affairs at Yale University, and prior to his appointment at Yale, he was for many years Professor of Philosophy at Columbia University in New York. As you'll see, he also holds conjoined appointments at the ANU and at the University of Oslo. Since 2004, he's been a professorial fellow at the Centre for Philosophy and Public Ethics at the ANU, and since 2007, research director of the Centre for the Study of Mind in Nature at the University of Oslo. And he's also a member of the Norwegian Academy of Science. During the course of his career, Professor Pogge has held many distinguished fellowships, including at the US National Institutes of Health, Princeton University and Oxford University. Professor Pogge has published widely in moral and political philosophy. He's written extensively on Kant's moral and political philosophy and also the political philosophy of John Rawls, who was his PhD dissertation supervisor. However, he's best known for his work on global justice. He's authored and edited over a dozen books on global justice, most notably World Poverty and Human Rights, which was first published in 2002 and then republished in a second edition by Cambridge University Press in 2008. His work on global justice has been translated into multiple languages, including German, Czech, Italian, Spanish, Portuguese, Turkish, Finnish, Chinese and Japanese. Professor Pogge has also published extensively on justice in healthcare, and his work in this area has drawn attention to gross injustices at the global level in access to life-saving medicines and in pharmaceutical research and development. The aim of his work on global justice and justice in healthcare is not just to diagnose injustice, but to develop concrete proposals for redressing injustice. And an example is the work he's done on a proposed health impact fund, which would provide incentives to pharmaceutical companies to develop low-cost drugs to target diseases that have the greatest global impact on health, such as tuberculosis and malaria. So Professor Pogge's lecture tonight focuses on global poverty and human rights. Its title is Human Rights as Constraints on Global Institutional Arrangements. So please join me in welcoming Professor Pogge to Macquarie and thanking him for coming here.
So thanks very much for this great introduction. And I will try to keep this reasonably short and leave as much time as possible for discussion, because that's, for me at least, the more interesting part, and I'm a selfish creature. So, and you are welcome to keep the PowerPoint if you want it, so you don't have to scribble things down, even if you find something of interest there. And I start with the idea of human rights, which is central to this lecture. So human rights, I think, are best thought of in connection with human responsibilities, the counterpart duties or obligations that we incur through the human rights of others. And that's a topic that is much neglected. People love to talk about human rights and how everybody has a right to this, that, and the other thing, but they don't talk a lot about the responsibilities that go along with them. But I think we should, in thinking about human rights, always keep responsibilities in mind. And it makes sense to distinguish three different ways in which we could be related to a human rights deficit. One would be that we are unrelated causally. There's nothing we can do. The human rights deficit exists, and there's nothing we can do, and therefore no responsibility for us to do anything to alleviate it. A very obvious example is human rights deficits in the past. There's nothing we can do to alleviate them, and so we have no responsibilities. Secondly, there are positive responsibilities or positive duties with regard to human rights deficits that we are in a position to avert through active intervention. And here in the famous words of the United Nations, we have duties to protect and to fulfill. But the most weighty, most stringent duties that we have with regard to human rights are those not to violate them or to respect, in the language of the UN. We are not to knowingly cause or aggravate human rights deficits through our active intervention. So if we do that, we fail in our responsibilities to respect human rights, and we are therefore violating our human rights related negative duties. So that's a rough distinction between the different kinds of responsibilities, in particular positive and negative responsibilities, which are of course consistent with each other. It's possible that with regard to a particular human rights deficit, you have responsibilities of both kinds. Now, standardly, we think about human rights violations in interactional terms. We think in terms of an actor or a group of actors who are acting in ways that violate the human rights of other human beings. So human rights violations, again, that corresponds to the respect, the duties to respect as the United Nations distinguishes them. Now, and as an analysis of that concept of a human rights violation, you would normally think about four or five elements. Namely, first, there must be unfulfilled human rights. There must be a human rights deficit. Secondly, that deficit must be causally traceable to human agents. Third, these agents must be active in some way. It's not enough that these agents are failing to do something to alleviate the deficit, but rather they must be actively doing something to bring it about, to keep it in existence, or to aggravate it. Fourth, many would say that these agents must be acting in some official capacity. So most people would say that when one person beats another person over the head, that doesn't really amount to a human rights violation unless the first person is acting in some sort of official capacity. I leave that open because it doesn't matter much whether we accept that condition or not. And fifth, finally, the person who is the potential human rights violator must intend, foresee, or be in a position to foresee that his or her conduct is causing this human rights deficit. So if, unbeknownst to you, some complicated mechanism is wired in such a way that when you touch it, somebody else will be harmed very severely, and you had no way of knowing that that would occur, again, you would not be considered a human rights violator, even though you harmed some person very severely. Now, I'm working with the concept of an institutional human rights violation, which in a sense is just a species of interactional human rights violation, where you might say, well, institutions, namely rules that structure a particular social system, they can also violate human rights. They can also produce human rights deficits. So this thought is a pretty familiar thought from theories such as Rawls's, for example, where you say the way we organize our institutional order, the way we arrange the basic structure, can have important repercussions for the fulfillment of human rights and for many other ways in which lives can go better or worse, life prospects, as Rawls calls that. And so we can think of institutions also as having responsibilities in an anthropomorphic sense to fulfill human rights and to respect human rights. But really, and that's the sense in which it's a species of interactional human rights violations, really institutions are ultimately designed and upheld and enforced by human beings. And so you can also think of these particular violations as being ones that are committed via institutions. So one group of human agents can violate the human rights of others with weapons, and they can also do so with institutions by designing an economic order that foreseeably and avoidably causes or keeps in existence very large human rights deficits. So here, parallel to the first case, we can also distinguish five conditions. There has to be a human rights deficit, but here I would think that the human rights deficit has to be only statistical. So think of, for example, Stalin's new policies in the late 20s and early 30s, or think of feudalism. The economic order was designed in such a way that foreseeably it caused a lot of excess deaths from hunger deprivation, but it's not clear whether we can trace of each and every person who died during that period whether that person would have survived if the institutions had been different. And I submit that that's not necessary. So long as we know that a large number of excess deaths occur, then we can hold these institutions responsible for the excess deaths or deprivations, even if we cannot be certain with regard to any particular person, that that person would not have died if the institutions had been designed differently. So secondly, that human rights deficit, the excess mortality or whatever it happens to be, must be traceable to social rules, to an institutional order, which thirdly is being designed, upheld, imposed, enforced by particular individuals who are playing an active role in maintaining that institutional order. Again, the rules have to have an official character. You could add that or not. That's sort of a discretionary condition. They appear with a claim to moral legitimacy, and they demand compliance on moral grounds. And finally, fifthly, the agents who are involved in maintaining that institutional order or designing it intend, foresee, or are in a position to foresee that these rules produce human rights deficits, and that there is an alternative institutional order, an alternative way of designing these rules that would not lead to comparable deficits. So the deficits are not only there, but they're also reasonably avoidable. So that would be the account of an institutional human rights violation. Now, this account is different from the interactional in one important respect. When we think about interactional violations, we normally go from an empirical assessment that a person harmed another person to a moral assessment where we say, this person did something wrong. And the empirical notion of harm here operates with some sort of an empirical baseline, which could either be diachronic or subjunctive or state of nature. In the first case, you say A harmed B if A did something as a result of which B was worse off after A acted than B was before A acted. So that's a harm diachronic. You become much worse off as a result of a piece of conduct that somebody else inflicted on you. A second option would be that you become worse off at this time than you would have been at this same time if that person hadn't acted. So that's a subjunctive account. You're comparing how well off a person is at the same time, actually, versus hypothetically if the person hadn't acted. And a third one, which is sometimes used by Lockeans, for example, is a state of nature account, where you say that you're harming people only insofar as you make them worse off than they would be in a state of nature kind of situation. Now, in the institutional account, it works a bit differently in that here, in order to speak of a deficit that people are suffering, you're already presupposing a certain kind of baseline and saying that this is how well off people should be. This is what we consider the baseline for harming to be. And that's a moralized baseline. So we could have an ambitious theory of justice and say that in a just society, for example, everybody should be served fresh milk in the morning, and so everybody who's not being served fresh milk in the morning is being made worse off. If fresh milk being served in the morning is feasible, and if your society doesn't provide it, then your society is imposing an unjust order upon you and is harming you by not providing the milk. So this would be, of course, an extravagant conception of justice, but it is in the spirit of the way in which I understand harm, namely that you have a moralized baseline. You say this is what justice requires of a social order. Anybody who is in the business of designing and imposing a social order on other people has to make sure that it fulfills these minimal conditions for the people on whom this order is imposed. And what these minimal conditions are you raising your hand? It is certainly possible, but whether this is in the spirit of the event, I don't know. That we have to ask the... Yeah, good. I mean, if it's in the spirit, then why don't you ask a question?
I was asking, what you're pretty much saying is that there is a moralized notion of harm,
So I'm not presupposing that. I'm basically explicating a certain notion of harm, how we can understand the word harm, what the word harm can be taken to mean. Right? And so in some cases, we compare before and after, and it's just an empirical matter. The person is harmed if the person is made worse off. And in other cases, we have a moralized notion. We say, if you bring a person below a certain baseline, you are thereby harming that person. So, and here the baseline, that is the point that I was just about to make, is a baseline that is moralized in the sense that it is parasitic on a certain moral theory, namely on what it is that we require an institutional scheme to achieve for the people on whom it is imposed. So we are imposing an institutional scheme on people, a set of rules. We are saying, okay, these are the rules under which you Australians now have to live, and we will enforce that against you. And everybody agrees that if you do that, then these rules have to satisfy certain minimal standards. For example, process standards, they have to be democratically adopted perhaps, but also substantive standards. So even if you all, the majority decides to mistreat a certain minority, that wouldn't be just. And so the harm, the notion of harm that results here then is you're harming people institutionally by imposing certain institutions upon them when these institutions are unjust. The harm is the imposition of unjust institutions, and so you need a theory of justice to tell you whether the institutions that you're now imposing or the imposition of these institutions constitutes a harm or not. So this account is supposed to be completely neutral with regard to what the standards of justice are. Don't need to be common standards across the world or anything like that. Does that help? And we can talk about it afterwards a bit more if you want. Okay, so these are the two ways in which harm and wrong or injustice can be related. And so I accept here that the notion of harm is moralized. And then, of course, you have to have the right conception of justice, the appropriate conception of justice, so that you can then decide whether a particular imposition of institutions counts as harming people or not. So what I propose in that role for the global institutional order is very minimal, namely basically just to say human rights. So all that a global institutional order, a system of rules that be imposed worldwide or supranationally, all it has to do is it has to maintain human rights, fulfill human rights, realize human rights insofar as that is reasonably possible. Now, do I believe that any global order that fulfills human rights is therefore a just order? I certainly don't. But what I ask you to accept is only that it is not a just order if it leaves avoidable and foreseeable human rights deficits. So then we get an account of what makes an institutional order compliant with human rights or non-compliant. It's non-compliant if, actually I should say compliant, no, non-compliant, good. If the following four conditions all hold, then it is non-compliant. Namely, first, it must be associated with a human rights deficit. Secondly, that association must be reasonably avoidable. There must be a different way of organizing that system of rules that governs the particular social system in such a way that this deficit would be much smaller or non-existent. Thirdly, the ongoing deficit in number one is foreseeable. And fourth, the fact that it could be avoidable through a different arrangement of these institutions is also foreseeable. So when these four conditions are fulfilled, then the institutional order in question is a human rights violating order, and those who are participating in designing and imposing it are then human rights violators, violating the human rights of those subjected to that order through knowingly imposing this order upon them. And this is not a terribly original thought. It's a thought that already occurs in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, where we read that Article 28, that everyone is entitled to a social and international order in which the rights and freedoms set forth in this declaration can be fully realized. So I read that as making, in a somewhat less elaborate way, the points I just made, namely that among the human rights that we have is the human right not to be subjected to any kind of institutional order that does not allow the rights and freedoms set forth in this declaration to be fully realized. And I would add the word avoidably, that avoidably does not allow these rights and freedoms to be realized. So human rights can then serve not only as constraints on the conduct of individuals interacting with each other, but also as constraints on the kinds of institutional order, the kinds of rules that people may impose on one another. So it's a minimal condition of justice of a social order that it not foreseeably produce massive and foreseeably avoidable human rights deficits. If we are actively involved in designing or imposing an institutional order that does produce such human rights deficits, then we are, through that institutional order, harming people, violating their human rights, violating their human rights correlative negative duties. Now, why is that important? Why is that interesting? It's important, I think, because it upgrades the importance of human rights deficits that we find in our world today, which we normally put at the very bottom of our priority list. So we make two distinctions morally significant with regard to human rights correlative obligations or responsibilities. Namely, we distinguish between positive and negative, as I did at the very beginning of this lecture. And we also distinguish between the near and dear on the one hand and more distant strangers on the other. So we say that, sure, we should promote human rights and we should try to protect human rights, but first and foremost with regard to our near and dear, our friends, relatives, neighbors, then secondarily with people in our larger area where we live, our country, our compatriots, and so on. And people, distant strangers whose human rights may be under threat, are the lowest priority. They get the least weight. Helping them, protecting them, assisting them is of not very great importance. Now, all of that, I think, is fine. I'm willing to accept that, but it holds mainly for positive duties. It doesn't really hold for negative duties. So think about a case where somebody says, look, I like to drive drunk and so on, but I very carefully do that very far from Australia, where Australian tourists are unlikely to venture. And so, yes, I do endanger people, civilians there and so on, but I, you know, in Belize, why would any Aussie ever want to go there? And there you can bribe the police, and if you really hit somebody, you know, just pay $100 and you get rid of the charges and so on. Now, do we upgrade our assessment? Do we think that such a person is, you know, that's not a big deal to drive drunk in Belize if you have no reason to expect that Aussies would be running around there? I don't think so. I think that endangering children in Belize is just about as bad through drunk driving or through any other activities of that sort, is just about as bad as doing it in Australia. So with negative duties, that gradient is nowhere near as steep and maybe not even there at all, the gradient that goes from the near and dear outward to distant strangers. So by upgrading our responsibilities with regard to, for example, the massive human rights deficits that we find in the world today, like poverty, by upgrading them from positive to negative, I achieve two things. First, negative duties are widely regarded as much more stringent. And second, the usual fading away of duties as we go out to more distant strangers also isn't very present in the case of negative duties. So something is moving from the bottom right to the top right, and the top right is very close to the top left. And so it turns out that these duties, insofar as they exist, these negative duties I'm asserting, could deserve a place very close to the top of our moral priority list. It's important to think about whether we are not perhaps actively contributing to violating the human rights of large numbers of people by imposing on them global institutional arrangements that aggravate and perpetuate their poverty. So, and that's what I think is in fact the case. I think that we have now a system of international law that is designed through intergovernmental bargaining in which Australia, the European countries, the US, China play a leading role, and that these rules are in fact much more damaging to the fulfillment of human rights, then they might be. These rules could be improved very massively, and that would reduce the massive human rights violations, or massive human rights deficits, I should say, that we find in the world today. So international law is, for me, schizophrenic. On the one hand, you have the Sunday parts, which are celebrating human rights. Everybody has a human right to this and that and the other thing. Wonderful human rights conventions. On the other hand, you have a large body of international law that systematically violates massively the very rights that are being postulated in the Sunday part. Now, one problem, of course, here is that this sort of argument requires empirical support. You have to convince people that our international order, the rules that are very rapidly thickening, becoming ever more dense at the global level, these rules really have a causal importance with regard to how well human rights are fulfilled in the world. And that is what I now want to talk about. Now, many people think that that just can't be right. And the argument that is often repeated in the pages of The Economist and other like-minded newspapers and magazines is the argument that poverty develops very differently in different locales, and so it cannot be the case that global institutions, which after all are the same for everyone, play any role in explaining the evolution of poverty in the world. You have Taiwan, South Korea, Hong Kong, China doing very well. You have various African countries doing very poorly. And these huge discrepancies in the trajectory with regard to poverty of these various countries prove beyond a reasonable doubt that supranational institutions cannot be causally involved in poverty persistence. Now, the counterargument, I have two counterarguments. One is more conceptual, one is more empirical. The conceptual one just says that the argument is a non sequitur. Where I come from at Yale, we have at the end of a semester wide discrepancies in the performance of the students, and you cannot conclude from that that the capacity of the teacher, the quality of the teacher, is irrelevant to student success, right? You could make the same argument. You could say some students have done very well, some have done very poorly, so obviously I, the teacher, can have nothing to do with student success. That would be a grotesque mistake, as we all realize, insofar as we are either teachers or students, as I take it we mostly are. So let's count the ways in which this would be a mistake. First and foremost, if the teacher were better, maybe all the students would have done better, no matter how great the discrepancies among them. Or conversely, had he been or she been worse, the students would have done worse. Secondly, teachers select the teaching materials, the books and so on, and the teaching style, and thereby may cater more to one group of students than to another. So the needs, interests, preparations of different students are differentially engaged, and had the teacher chosen different materials or a different style, then maybe a group that didn't do very well would have done much better, and a group that did do very well would have done much worse. So even these discrepancies in the performance of the students may be influenced by choices that the teacher makes, by this global factor teacher. And thirdly, some of the student-specific factors that greatly contribute to or detract from learning success, such as motivation, can also be influenced by the teacher. So a sexist teacher will demotivate his or her female, likely her, his female students, and may then cause the very student-specific factor, which in turn explains why the students did worse in the class than the men students. So in all these different ways, the global factor teacher can have a profound influence on the performance of the students. As we all know, this is all trivial stuff. But in parallel, the same is true with regard to the design of global institutional arrangements, that these arrangements may be very favorable for a country like China and South Korea for whatever reasons specific to those countries, but very unfavorable to certain African countries. Or they may support and sustain and incentivize institutional factors locally that in turn are very harmful for poverty eradication. For example, corruption, bribery, or authoritarian rule. So the argument simply doesn't go through. It doesn't show what it purports to show. Yes, there could be very large discrepancies in the performance of countries, and that would be perfectly consistent with global institutional factors playing a major role in explaining why so much poverty persists. I went in the wrong direction. So that's the conceptual answer to the counter argument, and I want to talk now a little bit about the empirical side of it. So what are important features of our global order that play a role in the perpetuation of poverty? And just name a few just so that you get a sense of what might be involved and how important these factors might be. In some ways, the global institutional order affects the life prospects of individuals directly, and that happens, for example, in the rules of trade and finance, where despite the fact that the WTO agreement was supposed to bring a major market opening, free markets, no borders, and so on, in the end, the rich countries managed to grandfather in a lot of protectionist measures, such as tariffs and quotas and anti-dumping duties and subsidies, export credits. Subsidies alone are between $250 and $300 billion a year that are still being paid by rich countries to their farmers in particular and their textile producers and so on, which has the effect, on the one hand, of excluding imports from poor countries that would be competitive if our industries weren't subsidized, and also from allowing our exports to dominate world markets by making our products artificially cheap. That's well understood and often bemoaned even by libertarian economists. Permissive environmental rules. Again, these rules are ones where polluters can create a lot of harm through pollution. The people most vulnerable to these harms are poor people in poor countries, and polluters don't pay. They just put that pollution out there. These rules could easily be conceived differently. They could be done so that polluters do pay and have to pay the price for the externalities that they inflict on other people. Much more logical way of writing these rules. So again, by having one set of pollution rules rather than another, we are greatly aggravating difficulties among poor people and poor populations. Other rules at the global level work against human rights fulfillment more indirectly, namely by sustaining, like the sexist teacher, student-specific or country-specific factors that work against poverty eradication. So a very important, very obvious and yet unobvious rule to that effect is the rule that we recognize anyone who holds effective power in a country as entitled to sell the resources of that country, to borrow money in the name of the country, to sign treaties, and to import weapons, all of that regardless of how that person came to power or exercises power. That rule is very convenient for rich populations because we can buy resources we need from anybody, no matter how they came to power or how badly they rule. But the rule is a very bad rule for poor populations in poor countries, especially the more resource-rich poor countries, because they become very easy targets for predatorial authoritarian regimes, generals, resistance movements, whatever. Somebody who takes power by force and then entrenches him or itself in power by selling resources and importing weapons that they need to stay in power. It doesn't matter that you're totally unpopular or that 98% of the population hate you. You maintain yourself in power with weapons that you buy for the resources that you sell. Intellectual property rights, I'll say something towards the end, maybe a little bit. Labor standards, again, not terribly important. I want to speak lastly about illicit financial flows, a big problem, again, that I think massively contributes to poverty. We all know, and are often reminded, how much development aid we give to poor populations. It's about $120 billion a year from all the rich countries combined. What we don't learn very often is that about 10 times as much money flows in the opposite direction in various ways, where money gets siphoned off poor countries into the Western banking system. This happens in various different ways. One is just embezzlement, where our banks are permitted to take money, even if they suspect this money to be stolen in poor countries. In the US, for example, there are two types of monies that have to be reported by banks to the authorities if the bank suspects that the money comes from or is in any way related to terrorism. It has to be reported. And if the money is in any way related to drug dealing, it has to be reported. If the bank suspects you of trafficking in women or children, it doesn't have to be reported. That's just fine. Come to us, deposit it here. And that's quite typical for the banking systems of many Western countries, that they accept this money with open arms because it's just nice to get money in. It's good for the economy of the country. Again, the rules could be different, and if they were different, then possibilities for stealing money would be much diminished. An even larger position in this $1 trillion siphoning off of money is tax avoidance schemes of various sorts. So we require multinational corporations to file only one consolidated tax return showing that they had so and so much profit and that they pay taxes on all this profit somewhere. Now, where do companies like to pay taxes on profits? Obviously, where the rates are lowest, Cayman Islands, Bermuda, something like that. And so all these countries are practicing transfer pricing shenanigans where they consolidate their profits in these low-tax jurisdictions. So, for example, they produce in India, they sell in South Africa. So they first sell from India to the Cayman Islands at a low price, so there is no profit in India. Then they sell from the Cayman Islands to South Africa at a high price, so there's no profit in South Africa where the products are sold. But there's a lot of profit in the Cayman Islands where the company has only a telephone and a guy manning the telephone and no other operation, no customers, no production, nothing. But that's where all the profit accumulates, and that's where the company then pays taxes on its profits. Again, these rules are very detrimental, obviously, to poor countries because poor countries don't have the capacity to tax these operations that take place in their countries of production and consumption. So these are examples of aspects of our international rule system that I think play a major role in explaining why poverty persists to the extent that it does. You can see this here again diagrammatically summarized. The idea is then that poverty persists, that's the right bottom part of the diagram. Why does it persist? Well, national institutions play a role, global institutions play a role, but some of the defects in national institutions are themselves sustained and incentivized by defects in global institutional arrangements. For these global institutional arrangements, the governments of the more powerful countries bear responsibility. They are the ones who are negotiating these institutional arrangements. And again, for their conduct in these negotiations, we bear responsibility. The citizens of the more powerful countries are responsible for what their governments do in their name, including what they do at the negotiating table when they design and uphold and enforce these global institutional arrangements. Now, let's look whether we have some empirical evidence that something like that is actually happening. What we find is that international inequality, what used to be the forever rising inequality that dominated the last 200 years or so, has actually stalled. So the poor countries as a group are now doing quite as well as the rich countries as a group, thanks to China and India in particular, and maybe even a little bit better. But global inequality is still increasing, and it's increasing no longer because of increasing international inequality, but because of increasing intranational inequality, and also because within the two groups, namely the group of rich countries and the group of poor countries, there are also, in particular among the poor countries, centrifugal tendencies at work. So if you just ignore borders for a moment and just look at the world's population as one big group of individuals or households, you see that inequality has massively increased in the globalization period. Ventiles are 20ths of the world's population, or groups of 5% each, and I've simply gone down from the top to the bottom, cutting the world's population into equal ventiles, 350 million people each, and giving you here the result about what percentage of global household income each of these ventiles has to spend. And what you find there is, first, that inequality is very massive, namely that the top ventile has 46% of global household income, whereas the bottom half has not even 3%, the bottom quarter, 0.75%. Or to put it differently, the people at the top, which includes most of us at least at some point in our lives, have about 9 times the average income of the world, whereas the people in the bottom quarter have 1/32nd of the average income. So each of them, or rather each of us, has as much income as 300 of them. So it's a huge discrepancy between the top 5% and the bottom 25%. But what I really want you to focus on is the development over time, this crucial globalization period, 1988 to 2005, which are the most recent data available. We find that one ventile actually increased its share of global household income by 3.5%, and that's the top ventile, and the others all basically lost. The second ventile essentially stayed flat, and the lower ones all lost quite significantly. The bottom quarter of the human population lost fully 1/3 of its share of global household income, going from a bizarrely small 1.16% to an even more grotesquely small 0.75%. So there is a strong centrifugal tendency in play. What we also find is that the traditional correlates of inequality, so that it was had to do with gender, with race, with nationality, language, and so on, that's receding. But nevertheless, even though these correlations are receding, inequality as such is still quite heavily on the increase. So present trends would point to a future where we have ever-increasing inequality in the world among households or individuals, but where that inequality is ever less correlated with the nation you live in, your gender, your religion, your language, your nationality, and so on. One example of rising inequality in the U.S., maybe not that interesting, but you can see here how dramatic that shift has been, that in the United States, the top 1% of the population has experienced a major increase since 78, which was the turning point, going from 9% to 23.5%, and smaller segments, the top 1/10 of 1% and the top 1/100 of 1%, experienced even larger increases in their share, 4.6-fold and 7-fold respectively. So a very, very massive increase between 78 and 2007. The top 1/100 of 1% of the U.S. population, 30,000 people, 14,400 tax returns, now has nearly half as much income as the bottom half of the U.S., 150 million people, and about 2/3 as much as the bottom half of the human population, 3.4 billion people. So really quite massive increases. But our attention should be focused not only at the top, where inequality is very, very heavily concentrated at the very, very top, but it should also be focused, of course, at the bottom, where the fact that the poorest, the bottom quarter, has lost 1/3 of its share of global household income makes for increasing deprivations, or at least no eradication of deprivations. Yes, there is increasing average income in the world, but if you're losing in a short 17 years 33% of your share of global household income, then you are not participating in that increasing average income. In fact, you are probably losing in absolute terms. So these are the numbers from the hunger front. Hunger is a good example because it's reasonably objective to measure. It's not so difficult to measure. It's not subject to all the manipulations that are being visited on other measures of poverty. So as far as hunger is concerned, you can see a steady decline until about the mid-1990s. And at that time, hunger increased. The number of hungry people increased. It broke the 1 billion mark for the first time ever in all of human history in 2009, and will break that record this year because of very high food prices. So more than 1 billion people are chronically undernourished, and I flagged here the number 788 in red because that was the year in which the World Food Summit in Rome saw all the governments of the world coming together behind the commitment to reduce the number of hungry people to half its present level. So 394 million poor, hungry people are permissible by the year 2015. That was later modified and greatly diluted into the Millennium Development Goal number one. But the initial promise was that we would halve that number by 2015. You can see that it went very dramatically in exactly the opposite direction. And so more generally, there are lots of deprivations of that type, deprivations of poverty, not just food. And all the rights, or all the aspects of these rights that are listed here in Article 25 of the Universal Declaration are in fact flagging badly, and more people are suffering deprivations in many of these dimensions. So here you see the latest figures. Again, you can get the PowerPoint afterwards, so it's not worth lingering too long on them, but you can see that we have very large numbers of people being deprived in all these different aspects of lacking safe drinking water, adequate shelter, electricity, adequate sanitation, literacy, essential medicines, and so forth. That accounts also for about a third of all human deaths. About 18 million annually die from poverty-related causes, counting conservatively only those causes of death that are very highly correlated with poverty, so those which are basically unknown in the wealthier countries. And if you add that up, 18 million a year over a 20-year span, you get to 360, 370 million people. And you can see in this diagram that that absolutely dwarfs the big catastrophes of the 20th century that we like to focus on, such as the World War II or Mao's Great Leap Forward or events of that sort. So it's really a very massive problem. So if this is a human rights violation, as I claim it is, it would be a rather large human rights violation. Now, what can we do about this whole thing? How can we maybe mobilize change for that? I want to leave you with a somewhat more optimistic final point, and that is that I think we have to contest at the level of institutional design. It's not enough that we all volunteer a little bit, give a little money to Oxfam, maybe volunteer a little bit of time and effort for a good organization that helps and protects people in the developing world, but we have to think very clearly and very critically about these institutional arrangements at the supranational level. What has happened, of course, is that there has been a tremendous shift upward of the rules that govern our day-to-day lives from the national level to supranational levels. More and more rules have shifted upward, and this global network of rules and regulations also increasingly constrains and structures and influences national rules. So national rules that used to be pretty freely designable by national legislatures are now very heavily constrained and preempted by global agreements, supranational agreements. These supranational agreements are ones that are made, as I said, by powerful governments, but they are made in a way that is not transparent, with very little accountability. People don't know beforehand what is being negotiated. We have almost no way of influencing what happens there. But of course, big corporations, big banks, industry associations do have influence by lobbying their governments, which sit at the negotiating table and can then do their bidding in these negotiations. And so why these rules are so hostile to the poor, I think, is not because anybody hates the poor, nobody does, but because the people who sit around the table and are haggling out what these rules should be, and the people who are in a position to lobby those who sit around the table, are the most powerful economic agents on earth. The big banks, the big companies, the big industry associations, they are the ones who influence what these rules are, and through negotiations among them, through a kind of bargaining among these very powerful players, these rules get shaped. Now, if these people try to satisfy each other in order to get as much as possible, then it's a foreseeable, if unintended, side effect of that, that the interests of poor people, and that in this case includes 80 or 90% of the world's population, are being neglected. So that's what I think is happening. We should try to work for, of course, greater accountability, greater transparency, greater democratic participation in decision-making about these rules. And we should also think about what modifications of these rules could work to better protect the poor, to reduce these huge human rights deficits that we have in the world today. And so on that point, just sort of a laundry list of things that a reform project should ideally satisfy. Any kind of reform at the global rule level should be structural. We shouldn't only work on trying to protect poor people piecemeal, but we should also think about how we can make supranational institutions less hostile to them. We should try to find a reform that is quite openly and on the face of it a moral reform that highlights the interest in fulfilling human rights or discontinuing the violation of human rights. We should try to find reforms that are realistic in the sense that they also benefit at least a faction of the rich and mighty who might have veto powers over these reforms, at least initially. We should try to find a reform that's scalable, that can be started with relatively low resources and can then be scaled up in a way that learns from experience. We should find a reform that strengthens those who are the natural allies of reform, namely in particular the people in the bottom 60-70% of the world's population. And finally, something that can serve as a model for additional reforms in the future, something that is replicable. And it was with these sorts of considerations in mind that I thought up this Health Impact Fund idea, which I will, at the conclusion, quickly introduce to you only in a single slide so that you see what the idea is. It's basically the idea is to institute a new, to create a new international agency whose function it would be to incentivize pharmaceutical innovation. We now have, of course, a mechanism incentivizing pharmaceutical innovation, the development of new medicines, and that is patents. Patents exist, and they are one size fits all in all countries. All countries, through the WTO agreement, it's a wonderful example of everything I've been talking about, have been constrained to offer the same type of patent, namely 20-year product patents, and you can get them in any country in the world that is a WTO member, and that means essentially every country in the world. Product patent means that, in contrast to a process patent, you can no longer invent around the patent. In the past, you could invent around patents, and the Indians were very good at doing that, by finding a different process for making a molecule other than the process that was patented by the innovator. You would retroengineer the molecule, and then you would find a different way of producing it, and that was perfectly consistent with the patent because the patent was on the process of making the molecule. Product patents don't allow you to do that, and so the whole molecule is off limits once it's patented in any country in the world. And of course, 20 years is a long time, so poor people have to wait for generic availability of a product until those 20 years are up, or 12, or whatever the time may be from the point of market clearance. So the Health Impact Fund is a complement to TRIPS. It allows innovators voluntarily to register a new product with the Health Impact Fund, and if they do so, they are rewarded out of the fund in proportion to the health impact of the medicine. So if you register a product, you get 10 years of reward payments that are proportional to the health impact worldwide of the product that is estimated or measured through health impact assessments. The rewards would be funded by willing governments, a coalition of governments, each of which would contribute, let's say, 0.01 or 0.02% of their gross national income to the Health Impact Fund to maintain something like $6 billion annually in the fund at all times, so that every year $6 billion could be distributed among registered products, each product getting a share of the $6 billion that corresponds exactly to the share of health impact that it achieved relative to the health impact that all the registered products achieved. What does the registrant have to do in return? Well, they have to give up the other incentive, namely the incentive that comes from markups. They can no longer mark up their product. They have to sell the product at the lowest feasible average cost of manufacture and distribution. The way we could enforce that is that we require the registrant to put the production of the product out for tender, find the cheapest reliable manufacturer, give the contract to them, get the product from them, and then sell it to patients at the same price at which they buy it from the manufacturer. That way, we would be sure that we would always get the lowest feasible price because competing manufacturers would keep the price down. And we would also harvest economies of scale because the whole world production would be in the hands of one or two generic companies manufacturing the product. So that's the idea. The three advantages of the idea, of course, would be first, that neglected diseases, diseases concentrated among the poor that are extremely damaging, would become highly profitable research projects for pharmaceutical companies. They could now make a lot of money, which they currently cannot, on inventing a new drug for malaria or tuberculosis or whatever. Secondly, any medicine that is registered with the Health Impact Fund would be available for a very low price from the very moment that it hits the market. Poor people would not have to wait 10 or 15 years to have access to these medicines. And thirdly, pharmaceutical innovators would be strongly incentivized to try to overcome any kind of last mile problems between the medicine's availability and its actual accessibility for poor people. So, for example, if refrigerators are needed to keep the product fresh, then innovators will have an incentive to see to it that refrigerators are there so that their product can have a health impact where it matters, that they can make a profit. If there are not enough doctors and nurses, or if the instructions about how to take the medicine to optimal effect are unknown, again, innovators have strong incentives to overcome these problems. Obviously, innovators shouldn't do this alone. Health ministries and health professionals in poor countries should play a valuable role in this as well. But it would be very nice to have big pharmaceutical companies with deep pockets and quite creative ways of making money in the mix as well, focused on increasing their profits by enhancing the health impact that their medicines achieve. So that's a quick nutshell account. And I think we should think more and more creatively about institutional reforms in order to stop this terrible slide, this terrible sort of downward spiral, where we have now increasing inequality leading to increasing control over global institutional arrangements, which in turn give increasing shares of the global product to rich people, which in turn further aggravate the human rights deficits that we find in the developing world. Thank you. The point that I actually made is slightly different. What I said was that the main driver of increasing global inequality today is increasing intranational inequality. But of course, the international inequalities are still very, very, very large, and much, much larger than intranational inequalities. So it's the increase that I'm talking about, the DDX, so to speak. The increase in global inequality is driven. It's not anymore the case. What used to be the case, let's say from 1830 to 1995 roughly, it was the case that the poor countries as a group and the industrialized countries as a group were drifting further and further apart. That happened through colonialism and whatever else, and basically they arranged a trading system that allowed the rich countries to thrive. Now that has stopped. The poor countries as a group are doing quite as well, thank you very much, as the rich countries, if not a little better. But there's a huge diversity within the poor country group. So some are doing very well, China and so on. Others are not growing at all, many in Africa. So that's still a centrifugal force. But also increasing intranational inequality now is a very important contributor to increasing global inequality. So about the point, of course you are right that domestic institutional factors play a very major role in explaining increasing intranational inequality where it increases. But if I'm right, then this is just like the sexist teacher, namely that these internal factors are very strongly influenced by external factors. So again, take the example of the privileges. Right? So we say to everybody in Africa, we announce that we will buy resources from you guys, and we'll pay anybody who holds power in one of these African countries. We'll, you know, if you have power, you get the money. So what incentive does that set for generals or for anybody, right? They now say, well, if I can get myself to power, I don't need to be nice to the people in this country. I don't even have to let them live. All I need to do is sell resources to foreigners and collect the money, then buy myself weapons with which I stay in power, and I can play that forever. Now, since everybody knows that, it's clear that the military, for example, anybody who is somehow in a position to take power by force, can now blackmail those people who are in fact in power. So why does corruption among military people in Nigeria, why is that rampant? Well, it's very obvious, because nobody, even a democratically elected president, can shut it off. Because if they shut it off, they know if the military is reduced to some ordinary salary, they can take power any time, and then sell the resources, import weapons, hold themselves in power, as they've done through most of Nigeria's history. And so even in situations where the military isn't directly in power, it certainly changes the bargaining equilibrium and makes it impossible for governments to stamp out corruption. And that then leads to intranational inequality, where the elite, top military brass and a lot of other elite players, accumulate a lot of the wealth, and the rank and file get very little of all that wonderful resource wealth that Nigeria has. Can you try to speak up a little bit so that... Australia being a stagnant country, this was not my impression, but I think that you're doing very well in the moment compared to the Europeans and the US, where there seems to be something slightly worse than stagnation setting in. But so let me say a little bit about what would be relevant for the legal profession. Take again the resource privilege. Right, this resource privilege, I think, is something that is accepted by and large around the world. But I think we should look at the various laws that are already on the books that might challenge the resource privilege. And we might also think about constructing maybe laws that would better protect the population of developing countries. Right, you and I agree probably that morally speaking, there's absolutely no reason why a Suharto or Mobutu Sese Seko or Sani Abacha should be entitled to collect money for resources that are not belonging to him, right? The principle is that the resources of a country belong to the people of that country, and if the people of that country choose to delegate that authority to a government, that's perfectly fine. But sorry, they didn't in the case of Abacha and these other people. And so why should we be fences? Why should we accept stolen resources and pay for them and allow companies like Shell, BP, Exxon, and so on to sell stolen goods in Australia, which they got, which they have property rights to, thanks to the fact that they paid some dictator or tyrant in a developing country? And so we might see whether there are legal mechanisms already on the books that forbid the purveying of stolen goods, or we might think about whether we could change the existing legal order in such a way that we say that only governments that are minimally representative of their people can be considered legitimate transferors of ownership rights in these resources. So if you have paid some tyrant who happens to be in power in some country a sum of money, that does not make you the owner of the resources that that person handed over to you if this person had no legitimacy. So I think that would be an interesting topic to explore, and where we could make, I think, a major difference to how well governed many of these countries are. You've probably heard about the resource curse, which is the general label that economists have given to this phenomenon that resource-rich countries do very poorly in economic terms, and especially in poverty eradication. On the face of it, very, very surprising, because you would think that if a country has ample resources, natural resources, then like Australia or Norway, they should be doing well. But many of them don't, and of course the reason for that is precisely this, that we recognize these rulers in advance. You know, we basically put a price on the head of democracy in these countries and say, if you can grab power by force, we'll pay you. You get the money for the resources. So think of legal ways in which one can undermine this resource privilege and can secure the obvious moral right of populations in the developing world to control and benefit from the resources on their territory. Okay, so let me sort of put it in a more concrete context, right? I deal a lot with Americans because I live in that country, and many of them have libertarian leanings of one sort or another. They're not sort of card-carrying Nozickians or Ian Randians or something, but they have these leanings. So they make a very strong distinction between positive and negative. And so they're very used to the kinds of arguments that Peter Singer presents, right? Singer comes in and says, look, you know, I tell you the story about the kid in the pond, and now let me tell you that you are really like that professor who didn't fish the kid out of the pond because you didn't send your check to Oxfam. And then people say, yeah, so big deal, big deal. I'm not required to pick kids out of ponds, and I'm not required to send checks to... That's just, you know, bogus. Then I enter the fray, and I say, okay, let's take those off the table, those positive duties. You don't have to fish kids out of ponds, and you don't have to send money to Oxfam to assist people. But now let's look at your negative duties. You're not allowed to harm people, right? You're not allowed to throw people into ponds. And you're not allowed to harm poor people, make their situation worse. But that's what you're doing. How are you doing that? Well, you're doing it because you are part of an organism, the American people or the United States of America, which as a collective is imposing extremely harmful rules and institutions, practices upon the world. These rules cause massive underfulfillment of human rights, massive human rights deficits. These rules could very easily be different from what they are. If the U.S. had a different posture in the bargaining over these rules, had taken different positions, had pressed for different contents, these rules would be very different. And if they were different in these very realistically feasible ways, then the existing human rights violations or deficits, I should say, the existing deprivations would be much, much smaller than they are. So I have to show two things here. I have to show, on the one hand, that the United States plays an important causal role in these institutions being as they are, actually three things. Secondly, that these institutions, the global rule architecture, plays a major role in explaining the persistence of massive human rights deficits. And thirdly, that you, this particular U.S. citizen, is part of the group of those who are responsible for the U.S. bargaining position being what it is, the U.S. pressing for institutions as they do, and so on. And so these have to be overcome, these three hurdles. Yeah, that is certainly true. Yeah, so I think as far as success is concerned, I mean, it's obviously I'm a pretty small potato in this larger universe. I give lectures, I write books, but Americans don't read much books, and they... Yeah, I mean, it's true. It's sad, but it's true. So I mean, at least these sorts of books, right? That you sell. I mean, my books are selling well compared to other academic books, perhaps, but 10,000 copies or 20,000 copies. But this is still not reaching 300 million people, right? Obviously. So I give lectures on, and you are right that many people. I mean, the argument impresses many people. It weighs with people, even people with the normal, healthy libertarian sentiments that are very widespread in the United States and so on. So I think it has some effect, and it has more of an effect, I think, often than the Singer-type arguments do. And, of course, the people who respond to Singer-type arguments, including myself, are my best friends. I don't have anything against it. I'm just saying, add this argument to the mix. I'm not saying it should displace Peter's arguments in any way. So that's the first thing. And then you asked about how does one answer the question of what people can do, what individuals can do. And what I standardly say is that this is something that depends a great deal on who you are, because we have to make our operation. We are a minority, and we have been losing ground dramatically since the day of the Vietnam War, for example, right? Since the early 80s, since Reagan came to power, roughly, this has been going down the tubes. Inequality in the United States has shot up dramatically. Inequality in the world has shot up dramatically, and so on. So we have very little to show, and so we have to make this relatively small operation as effective as we can. And we need people of different types. We need people who can work with the media. We need people who can think about it within UN structures, let's say, international organizations, NGOs, civil society movements, and so on. So many different people are needed, and it's not obviously the case that all of us should do the same thing, right? You shouldn't all be writing books about world poverty and human rights. That would be... And so each person should find a role in this larger enterprise that adds the most to the group, but to what the group achieves. And so it depends on what nationality you have, of what special abilities you have, of what you like to do, what will sustain your motivation over time, and so on, what you in particular should do. Yeah, so let me start with the second. The jurisdiction doesn't matter, right? We have duties towards those outside of our jurisdiction insofar as we affect them. I'm essentially taking here positive duties off the table, right, as I said earlier. So this is just a matter of do no harm. Don't harm other people. And certainly we have duties not to harm other people beyond our own jurisdiction, right? The Germans have an obligation not to invade Poland. And similarly, the Americans have an obligation not to pump the atmosphere full of harmful chemicals that make vulnerable populations subject to disease and so on. And they have an obligation not to pollute through institutional arrangements at the global level that foreseeably and avoidably cause massive deprivations among the poor. Now, so in that sense, the duties not to harm go beyond the jurisdiction. That was also the point of the Belize example, right? That you, when you drive drunk in Belize, even when no Australians are present, you nevertheless are harming people, and you mustn't do that. Now, the other thing was, what is the real America? Well, one wonders. I mean, obviously both phenomena that you gave, you know, Americans are very philanthropic. They give away more money per capita than many other countries. And so there is a certain feeling of responsibility, but there's also quite sort of a fundamentalist right-wing sentiment that makes the Americans quite aggressive in their foreign policy. They like to go to war. You know, when any kind of problem comes up, they say, okay, let's make war first, and if that doesn't work, we think of something else. So there's a bit of this hyper-aggressiveness. So it's a country that is a colorful mix of sentiments, a kick-ass sort of mentality that they have. And one has to, in trying to influence them, you know, one has to fight for the soul of the country. One has to fight for the better America and try to latch on to what is good and in the ordinary population, try to develop that and try to mobilize it against some of the things that are bad, for example, excessive militarism and excessive dominance by big corporations. So what I see there happening is that this intransparency that I described about how international rules are designed also affects the United States itself, right? The foreign policy of the United States is very opaque to most of the American citizens. They don't know how it's made and what the U.S. stands for. The office of the U.S. Trade Representative, for example, is one of the most horrific institutions in the world, doing enormous damage by arm-twisting countries around the world to do things that are beneficial to American companies. And that is done. This goes on through Democratic and Republican administrations, no real change. And that is something that U.S. citizens should know more about and should take responsibility for and say, do we really want that? Do we really want our companies to promote it at the expense of very severe harm being inflicted on people in other parts of the world? So there should be a greater democracy and greater awareness on the part of people. The U.S. is a democracy in many ways in name only. People do vote, but essentially the system is more adequately described as a system of $1 one vote than a system of one person one vote. Because in the end, it's money that wins elections, and you need to have about $1 billion to have a credible presidential campaign, as Obama recently announced, and you need similar amounts, or somewhat smaller, but still very, very large amounts to be reelected as a congressperson or to be elected or reelected as a senator. And again, where does this money come from, right? Who can run successfully? Well, those people who have important backers, very rich backers, and these backers, very rarely are they hundreds of thousands of people giving $20 each, and much more often it's a few people giving very, very large amounts. And so that system is one that has been, you know, reforms have been tried, but it's failed, partly also because of the Supreme Court, which again and again struck down campaign reform legislation that the Congress had very laboriously passed. And so, again, I think one can hopefully make common cause with the majority of U.S. citizens who are also not beneficiaries of this pretty aggressive foreign policy stance that the U.S. government is taking and has to take given whom they are dependent on. So I think if the majority of American citizens even just took a sober and intelligent view of their own self-interest, they would find that many of the policies that the government is conducting in their names are not actually to their advantage.
Either my own
So in the case of migrants, for example, asylum seekers, people like that, is that?
In those cases, in something like the case of, if you take the West Bank, I'm not trying to get political at all, but as an example, you can look at economic problems or access to water as symptoms of it not being clear whether these duties are connected to one's own government, whether that is one's own government, or whether that's foreign government.
Mm. Yeah, so this is obviously a simplification relative to the real world, right? And what I was trying to get out of that was something very limited, namely to say that I explained the way ordinary people think about our relationship, our being well-to-do Western populations, including, of course, Australia, Japan, and so on, what our relationship is to very poor people in developing countries. And then the way we normally think about this is to say, well, you know, those guys are distant strangers, not so important. And secondly, we are related to them only as bystanders in a position to help. We are not, you know, they're in the soup under their own steam. And all that we have to do with them is really that we have an opportunity to maybe make their lives better, to protect them a little bit and so on. So then I say, well, no, these could actually be negative duties, and as negative duties towards even foreigners, they could be nearly as strong or quite as strong as negative duties towards your own compatriots. So that was what I made use of here for the purpose of this lecture. Now, you are right, of course, that there are complicated intermediate cases. For example, somebody may be a resident in a country. I'm now a resident in Australia, but I'm a German citizen. So which government, you know, what does this mean about the relationship? Do I have a special relationship to Australia that is different from my relationship to Burma, for example, and so on? And there might be people with multiple citizenships, and so there could be all sorts of intermediate cases where countries have special obligations towards people who are not their own nationals officially, but in some other way fall because they're on the territory. You have a certain duty of care, perhaps a duty to protect them, and so on, that you wouldn't have if they weren't on your territory. So I agree with all of that, and that's a complicated story, but not one that I needed for the purpose of this lecture. So, but I agree that these distinctions are too gross and simple for any kind of full account. One sense is descriptive in that basically I try to build a case for a conclusion that many people find surprisingly strong by appealing to premises that many people find weak to the point of triviality. So that's what a good argument is, right? A good argument takes you from something where you say, well, come on, this is obviously true. And I say, but then this follows unless you show me why it doesn't. So that's the idea. And so I can afford to throw the massive in because the massive is true in the world as it is, right? So somebody might say, well, if this is just sort of a minor difference that it would make to human rights fulfillment, then, you know, maybe other things such as preserving culture or natural heritage, all sorts of other things might come in and they might be comparable in importance. So I exclude that by putting in the word reasonably avoidable. I say it has to be reasonably avoidable, so not by chopping down all the trees or anything like that, which, again, is very easily fulfilled in our world. We wouldn't have to chop down all the trees in order to dramatically reduce poverty, and I can throw the massive in, because the difference that some of the reforms that I, you know, one I sketched in some detail and some that I sort of hinted at, the difference that they would make to human rights fulfillment would be massive by any stretch of the word massive. And so I can afford to put that in. I can afford to take positive duties off the table and so on. I can make as many concessions, you know, and I'm very happy to make them, because the conclusion is still amazingly powerful, even if we weaken the premises. Okay, so first of all, I don't think there are many real libertarians around there, and they are mostly in philosophy departments, and we don't have to pay a lot of attention to them. What we have in the real world are people with libertarian leanings who are seduced by some of the libertarian language and who, for example, fall for this illusion that when I pay taxes, you know, and the taxes then fund some sort of a medical system like Medicare in the United States or something like that, then it'd be my money goes to these people. And so on, who think that the gross income that they make, for example, is sort of an accurate measure of their worth or their contribution to the economy, things of that sort. So they are basically people with libertarian needs, and those are the people that I'm whom I'm trying to address. Now, remind me again what you wanted to ask about the libertarian... The first part.
Oh, okay. So what's your response to
Yeah, the property rights thing, right? Yeah, so basically, of course, libertarians could say, I mean, some libertarians have said to me, or people with libertarian leanings, they say, well, you're right, the present rules stink, and I'm against them, and I'm against them partly because they fund welfare and so on. And so I am not in favor of the existing scheme, and so whatever the consequence of the existing scheme may be, it's not my responsibility because I wasn't in favor of them, something of that sort. But I think that even if you confine it to the narrow property rights, as you did, we can make pretty good arguments. For example, with the resources, right? We say that what you've just done is you've just filled up your gas tank at the gas station. Now, by what right? I mean, you paid for the gas, that's true, but you paid somebody, namely the attendant or the gas station operator, for the gas that you put into your tank. But what entitles you to, through this payment, to contribute to depriving those people whose gasoline that really is, or whose oil that really is, of their property? Right? By what right does Sani Abacha, or whoever sold the oil in the name of Nigeria, by what right does that person own these resources? And if that person doesn't have title to the resources, then really shouldn't you be desisting from buying them further down the chain? So that would be one way in which you could run the argument with regard to property, that you would say that, sure, you know, libertarian type theory talks about acquisition and transfer and so on, a legitimate chain, but in the end, if the chain ends, if you follow it upward, in an illegitimate transaction, then all the subsequent transactions are also tainted. So would that be helpful? And then the second part of the question, I've been doing index all night, so I'm a little...
Yes, it seemed like your arguments give you a much stronger conclusion, something like a world welfare state, something like
yeah.
Actually growth inequality.
Yeah. So the thing that, I mean, you're referring to the global resources dividend, which I once proposed, which some people have likened to a welfare scheme. Basically, the idea there was that we reconceive property rights in natural resources and say that a very small portion of all the of the value of all the resources that are harvested anywhere in the world belongs to human beings in general, not just to those people who live near the resources. And so everybody pays a certain fee or a certain dividend, as I called it, on extracted resources, or rather the value of extracted resources. That money gets collected and is then used for poverty eradication. That makes sure that all people in the world, even the poor, get at least a small share of the value of the resources of our planet, at least insofar as people decide to extract it. So the authority, the control over resource extraction would continue to rest with the individual countries, but they would have to hand over a part of the value of the resource. So, I mean, I don't think that's exactly a scheme that is welfarist. It's a scheme that, again, has certain libertarian appeal, because you say that, you know, the resources of the world don't belong to anybody in particular, and to say that they should all belong to people who just happen to live on a certain territory, even before they mix their labor with them, is a pretty arbitrary assumption. Why shouldn't they belong? Why shouldn't all human beings have some inalienable right to at least a share in those resources? So the health impact fund, I mean, basically is a proposal, or it comes from the realization that these rules, how they are designed, that does a lot of damage, and that better rules are probably a more efficient way of improving the position of the poor than transfer payments. So I'm not really in favor of transfer payments, because they're very easily captured by elites in the poor countries, and there are all these leaky bucket problems that economists are very good at outlining. In some cases, transfer payments work. There's a cash on delivery movement now that seems to be working pretty well. But by and large, it is preferable, obviously, to stop the headwind that is blowing into the faces of the poor, that is holding them down, that is making it impossible for them to make a decent living, rather than maintaining that headwind and then trying to compensate for it by handing over money that is sort of a systematic band-aid to the problem. It's much better to abolish the problem, because that makes for a much more lasting and structural solution. No, that's not it. No, so you can leave the child badly off. You can just walk on your way, according to this negative duty account. You have not violated any negative duty if you just walk off and say, you drown, that's all right. So these are not my best friends who do that, of course, but this is, as far as negative duties are concerned, there's nothing to reproach you with. What you mustn't do is throw people into the pond. So you mustn't make the situation worse. You mustn't attach a weight to the child that drags the child under the water or something like that.
I thought from the discussion you were framing this immediate.
No, that would just be a linguistic trick. No. That's right. That's right. No, that would be a cheap trick that wouldn't go very far. Good. No. These are genuine negative duties. So what we are doing is we are making people worse off. So the thought that I'm inviting, basically, an analogy to the domestic case, where I think it would be much more familiar, would be something like this. If you operate a feudalist system, let's say, in a country, so you say here are a few estates, you know, large land holdings, 15 feudal landlords are owning Australia, and all the others, if they want to make a living, have to sell themselves to one or the other of these feudal lords, and that's how we organize our country. That would be an example. So here you would say, we've organized the country in a way that foreseeably leads to deprivations and so on and so forth. We could have organized the country in a different way. And by arrogating to yourself or to a certain group the power to determine what the rules shall be in Australia, you are doing something active. Namely, you are imposing a certain order on a population. And as a condition of you doing that, that order has to be just. You can do that only if the order that you're imposing is a just order. Then we have to say, well, what counts as a just order? And here, very minimally, I reduce it all and say, at the very least, whatever else, it has to satisfy or realize human rights insofar as that's reasonably possible. So that's where the active element comes in. Yeah, no, could have been better is certainly not enough, right? The baseline is given by justice. The institutions have to be just, and so what the content is, where that line is to be drawn between positive and negative, depends precisely on which conception of justice you have. And I'm using a very, very minimalist one. There could be lots and lots of positive duties. So, for example, if we maintain a global order that is more hospitable to the poor, gives the poor a fair share in global economic growth, for example, not just fulfills their human rights, but even makes sure that poor people can participate proportionately in global economic growth, if they so choose. That would be, according to this very minimal conception of justice that I proposed, a positive duty. That would be a good thing to do. Of course, poor people should participate in global economic growth, but it wouldn't be required by justice on that minimal conception of justice. Likewise, when for example, our government is not involved in, you know, today everything is interconnected and so on, but let's say 200 years ago, if a Swedish person could have done something about improving conditions for slaves in the United States and didn't do that, that would have been a clear failure to fulfill a positive duty, but wouldn't have been a problem in terms of negative duty. That person wouldn't have contributed to the problem, would just have failed to do what he can by way of helping to solve the problem. So I think the sort of standard thing that we associate with negative duties, namely that they are reasonably minimal, gets maintained, certainly if we don't have too extravagant a conception of justice. Now let me say a little bit about the libertarians, how the libertarians would operate. They would operate, I think, on two different levels, and at the bottom level would be the level of transactions. So there I'm harming you relative to the baseline that you have acquired before I acted. So that could be a very, very high baseline if you're rich. So if you're very, very rich, Bill Gates, and I take 20 cents from you, I've violated your rights. The second level is the level of what your rights are, what sort of transactional rights and so on exist within the structure under which you live. And there, I think, Nozick doesn't have a big theory about it, but Locke has a pretty interesting theory, which is that you start with a certain set of rules that he takes to be natural and obvious in the state of nature, and these rules can be changed with rational consent, if it is rational for all players to consent to a modification of these rules. So money gets introduced, government gets introduced, and each time Locke is at pains to show that these transitions are rational to agree to for individuals in the preceding state. So you get a kind of, just like you do on the first level, you get a kind of recursive account of justice. A present distribution of holdings is just if it emerged through a series of legitimate transactions from a prior holding that was just. And similarly, a certain system of rules is just if these rules emerged through processes of rational consent out of the rules that existed in the original state of nature, something of that sort. And so what a Lockean could say is that so long as there's at least a conceivable transition from one system of rules to another system of rules, which the participants at each time could have rationally agreed to from the state of nature, then the existing system of rules is at least on the face of it legitimate. And that would require showing that everybody today is better off than people were in the state of nature. And that's hard to show if we have a billion people starving, and a lot of people, I mean, a third of all human deaths from poverty-related causes and so on and so forth. So it's very difficult to say that in a state of nature, a billion people could have starved. And I mean, the state of nature couldn't have sustained that many people starving, and could it not have sustained a death rate of the sort that we now have? So that would be if you put the whole argument purely into Lockean terms. Now, my argument, you're right, is not at that point a libertarian argument, because I have in this human rights appeal a forward-looking, if you like, very broadly speaking, consequentialist theory of justice. I'm saying that we should judge institutions, institutional arrangements, by their effects, by what they achieve, and the one thing that they should minimally achieve is the fulfillment of human rights, insofar as that can be achieved at all. Yeah, which is valuable thinking. We need people like you on the team to. So, anyway, the first thing to notice here is that the Health Impact Fund has a fixed pool of money each year. All that money goes to pharmaceutical companies, to innovators. And so they can't cheat us. They can only cheat each other. That's very nice, because they also then have a very strong incentive to police each other, right? So when you do monkey business, when you sort of say, well, in Morocco, you know, I cured 100,000 people of blah, blah, blah disease, and so I want to claim so many quality-adjusted life years and so on, then other pharmaceutical companies will come into the mix and say, well, wait a second, that can't be right. You know, we operate in Morocco. We know a thing or two about Morocco, and we know about this disease. And no, this didn't happen. And you get challenged. Now, of course, we have to have our own people. The Health Impact Fund would have a staff of people who would, on a randomized basis, select packages, follow them up down the pipeline, would look by the cluster method at particular geographical areas, try to figure out how much impact the drugs that are in the Health Impact Fund portfolio have had in this or that or the other locale. So we wouldn't simply take companies' word for that. The company doesn't come to us and say, you know, we had a billion units of health impact. But we would check that out. We would allow companies to, of course, challenge our assessment and maybe even ask for reassessment, which they would have to pay for if it doesn't result in a significant increase in the assessed impact. But the basic idea is really that we assess it and we play off companies against each other in a competitive environment where companies compete for the pools each year, we'd have about 25-30 products on the health impact fund at any given time at the $6 billion level. That's roughly what we expect. So 2 to 3 products would come in every year, 2 to 3 products would drop off every year at the end of their 10-year reward period. And in between, we would just sort of try to estimate as best we can, not very precisely, but pretty well, how much health impact each of these drugs would have. The health impact fund one?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So you say that in a third point, I think, that you need willing government to put together all this money and discipline them. But I don't understand, like, willing government. Historically, there hasn't been any government that's willing to say, okay, that's right. So the right thing to do is put your money together and do something good for mankind. So why do you think that in this model,
yeah, I can answer that at great length because I talk to these governments a lot. So you get a second shot if you want.
Yeah. So and then the other thing, the second point, you say that there is this distribution for 10 years. Is there an actual? Is 10 years just a number, a hypothetical number, or there's actually calculations say, well, in 10 years you get back all the money that you have spent for developing the medicine and all the research and that?
Yeah. So the 10 comes out of the what is called the effective patent life. So a patent is 20 years, as I said, but people apply for a patent very, very early in the research process because they don't want others to interfere with their research. And so the time it takes from filing the patent application to having a marketable product typically takes away a good chunk of your patent time because also the approval process is pretty lengthy. You have to run clinical trials and so on. So what you really get at the end is roughly 10 years. And we want to, as far as possible, replicate the business model that pharmaceutical companies are used to. We want to sort of say, okay, you have two options. You can put your product on the patent track, in which case you get 10 years or so roughly of effective patent life. Or you could put it on the other track, the health impact fund track, and you get 10 years of health impact rewards. And so it's basically just to replicate. Now, what are the arguments that we make to governments? And again, I've talked to a lot of governments in developing and developed countries and so on. So the first thing that you say to a government in a developed country like Australia is you've got a problem with your health system because it's becoming more and more expensive. You're spending a greater and greater part of your budget on healthcare, of your gross national income on healthcare. And you have no clue what you're getting for it. So I talked to the PBS guys here in Australia. I went to the government building. And I said, okay, so you are a very intelligent operation. You pay for medicines. You know, you reimburse medicines on the basis of how effective they are and so on. They said, yeah, that's the idea. And then I said, okay, so how do you know how effective they are? I said, well, we know that from the clinical trials, of course. So I said, well, wait a second. I mean, medicine can work well in clinical trials. That doesn't mean that it works well in the real world. Why not? Because pharmaceutical companies have every incentive under the sun to overprescribe the medicine, to give it to people who will only be marginally benefiting and so on. In a clinical trial, everybody really has the disease. Everybody takes the medicine to optimal effect and so on. They look after that. But in the real world, you know, who knows whether people adhere to the regimen, whether they take the medicine properly, whether they are the patients for whom the medicine is indicated, right? A guy just walks to the doctor's office and says, oh, I saw this thing on TV and I wanna try that. I wanna, you know, I feel that a little bit and I wanna try this and see whether it helps me. And so on and so forth. And so I said to them, you know, if you really want to rationalize your healthcare system and stop this incredible waste of money, you have to begin to collect some data about how medicines actually work in the real world, what you're actually buying for this money. Right? Clinical trials, forget about it. That doesn't give you useful information. And every person perks up when you say this in a rich country because they all understand that there is this problem that more and more money is being spent without any sort of scientific evidence as to whether the money is well spent. And these drugs are incredibly important. I mean, expensive. So then I say the health impact fund would be a fantastic mechanism to pioneer real life assessment of the impact of drugs. That we have to do, and so let's do a pilot together. Let's try to pioneer a method of how one can actually do that and follow up the way a drug gets marketed and taken up by the population and so on. That's one point. The second point is to say, who is paying for innovation today? Basically the rich, and only the rich. They fund it. They fund it through the markup. Those who can afford it pay for the markup and pay for the new medicine. But they overpay in many cases because the innovators get much more money out of their monopoly than they need to replicate their innovation activity. For example, they fund not only research and development, but they also fund enormous advertising, which is totally wasteful because these companies are fighting over the same turf, right? So I'm trying to switch the patient from the Merck drug to the Pfizer drug, then the Merck guy comes and tries to switch the patient back, and in the end, nobody gets any richer, nobody really benefits. They litigate like crazy. They spend hundreds of billions of dollars litigating against generic companies, against each other, about the patents, about evergreening, about data protection, and so on and so forth. So again, there's an enormous waste in the present system that the Health Impact Fund would reduce. So what happens now is rich people pay for innovation and for all of it, and they hugely overpay, much more than would be necessary to stimulate that amount of innovation that they get. Poor people are excluded during the patent period. Who benefits from that? Exactly nobody benefits from that, right? So you could basically let poor people be provisioned with generic, very cheaply producible versions of the same medicine. And the only reason you're insisting that that not happen is because you're afraid that some of that cheap medicine will flow back and rich people will also be able to buy it. God forbid. And so millions of people die as a result of our incentivizing innovation in medicine in a certain way that doesn't allow poor people to have access. Now, the Health Impact Fund basically operates on the same principle. Who should pay for pharmaceutical innovation? Well, mainly the rich, mainly those with money. But let them pay differently. Instead of paying through markups that exclude the poor, let them pay through the tax system, and then they get the medicine for cheap because they've already paid for the innovation through the tax system, and let the poor people participate. That way, there's no problem of contamination that rich people take the medicine that was designed for poor people or whatever. Everybody pays the same low price, but rich people still, as you say, pay the lion's share of the expense of research and development, just like today. Yeah, so that would be a way of making development aid more effective, right? So if some money goes for that, goes for diseases that rich people don't suffer from, right, we benefit a little bit because we sometimes travel in Africa and we want to be protecting it, but not very much. So I agree with you. But so that would be a piece of very effective development aid. We would incentivize companies to develop a new medicine for malaria or a new medicine for tuberculosis. And again, we would get that medicine invented. We would then mass produce it and make it available to large numbers of people. We would incentivize the innovator to make sure that the medicine is optimally taken for optimal effect so that it really, really works and decimates the disease. And we would thereby accelerate a process that is already ongoing, namely the process where the burden of disease in poor countries becomes ever more similar to the burden of disease in rich countries. The composition, I mean, of the two is converging, and poor people are more and more suffering from the same diseases that we are suffering from, diabetes, heart disease, stroke, and so on. And so within 10, 20 years, the convergence will get to the point where essentially these massive communicable diseases, that it's just shameful that they still exist. They could be easily wiped out. they will go and right, think about the health impact fund as something that is designed for the next 10,000 years. So it's just the first little blip of 20 years where you would be asked to contribute a little bit to eradicating the diseases of the poor. But after that, it would essentially be a way in which you would fund research on diseases that you are just as likely to get as anybody else in the system. Yeah, so the short answer is that the second is a way station towards the first, right? So, of course, I want more wide-ranging changes to the global institutional arrangements than just the institution of the Health Impact Fund. It would be a little funny if I had this big picture of these massive human rights violations and then I gave you the little $6 billion Health Impact Fund and say, that will fix everything. But it won't fix everything for sure. It will fix a lot. It is a fantastic example of a reform that is feasible that we can actually institute, right? So again, somebody asked me earlier, what do I say to people who say, what can I do? I'm just a small potato and so on. How can I help? And I think what we have to do is we have to pay more attention to structural reforms. And I want to inspire people by saying, here's an example, and you can't tell me that this couldn't happen. The Health Impact Fund is small enough to be credible as something that could actually happen and would shift the balance of forces in the right direction and would make further reforms then more likely, more feasible. And it's large enough in its own right to make a massive difference to the fulfillment of human rights. It would really make a huge difference if we had a permanent source of pharmaceutical innovation immediately available at very low prices that would constantly, that namely this mechanism, which would constantly hone in on the most damaging diseases. So, again, thinking 10,000 years ahead, the Health Impact Fund will then target diseases or will inspire innovators to target diseases that today don't even exist, that we can't even conceive yet. It's a mechanism that will always try to inspire innovators to invent the things that are most needed by humanity. And that is a great thing. That will do an enormous amount of good over many generations if it gets instituted. And so it's not a small thing, but it is certainly not the whole enchilada, if you like. So, but again, if I just describe the whole enchilada, like a philosopher might be prone to do and say, okay, nice try the world as it is, but let me show you on the board what the world really, you know, would be like if I were in charge. Again, that sort of leaves people with a sense of hopeless utopianism, that how will all this ever come to pass, right? So you have to start somewhere, and I think the Health Impact Fund is a great place to start because it can serve as a model, for example, just nearby, about how you can incentivize innovation with regard to clean or green technologies, how you can incentivize innovation with regard to new seeds, agricultural innovations, seeds that use less fertilizer, less pesticide, and so on and so forth.